Michael O'Mara presents A Pocket Coach, The Self-Care Coach. Confidence, Kindness, Calm, Sleep. Written by Dr. Sarah Jane Arnold and narrated by B. Holland. The Confidence Coach. Wheresoever you go, go with all your heart. Confucius. Introduction. What is confidence? There's a lot of misleading information out there, many myths, beliefs, and expectations about what confidence is and how we're supposed to build it. It can leave us feeling stuck, inadequate, stressed, and confused. To clarify this important issue, I will highlight first what confidence is not. Then I will offer a clear, concise definition of what confidence is, from a psychologically informed perspective. Confidence is not narcissism. It doesn't involve extreme self-interest or egotistical self-admiration. It's very different from apparent competence, i.e., when someone seems capable and able to cope on the outside, but they're struggling and feeling distressed on the inside. Genuine confidence does not involve pretense. It cannot be built through the fake it till you make it approach, which suggests that by pretending to do things with confidence, you can develop confidence. This approach contributes to inauthenticity, not being yourself, shame, and self-judgment, because it infers that it's not okay to feel unconfident, it's not okay not to know, or to find some things difficult, and it's not okay to make mistakes, when in fact, the opposite is true. Genuine confidence, by contrast, is unpretentious and authentic. It involves three key aspects, and it takes time to develop. When all of the following aspects are present, we can say that a person possesses genuine confidence. A feeling of self-assurance, with a sense of trust in yourself, courage, and competence. An attitude that we can have faith in and rely on ourselves. There is an appreciation of our own abilities and qualities and a belief or hope that we can achieve a goal, perform well, and succeed. There is a willingness to try, an openness to experience and constructive self-talk, thoughts about yourself, others, and situations. An action. Actually doing something unfamiliar and challenging. Typically, there's the chance of success or failure, and the outcome may be uncertain. Confidence is often context-dependent. We can be confident in some areas and not in others, and with certain people more than others. We might feel confident at work but far less confident socially, for example. Confidence can fluctuate in accordance with other changeable factors too, such as stressful external events and our internal experiences, i.e. emotions, thoughts, and how the body feels physically. Developing confidence. We're not born confident. Confidence is a skill that develops through social learning, our experiences and relationships with others, family members, teachers, friends, partners, strangers, colleagues, etc. We learn a lot about confidence via modelling, observing others. In childhood, we watch how our caregivers and others around us conduct themselves in response to life's challenges. For example, their ability to manage stress and anxiety, or their willingness to try new things. We develop ideas about what's safe and what isn't, who we are, what the world is like, what others are like, what we can do and what we can't do. Our interactions with others shape our emerging sense of self and confidence. If we're not supported in trying new things, or we're not taught how to cope with the consequences, the outcomes, thoughts, strong feelings and sensations of trying, then naturally we'll prefer to stay safe in our comfort zone. If we try new things and our experience is perceived as positive, then we'll want to do it again and perhaps try more new things. This is a learning process called positive reinforcement. If, as a consequence of trying, we experience emotional and practical challenges that we don't feel equipped to cope with, then it's likely that we'll be put off by the prospect and our ability to build genuine confidence will be limited. Our personality traits. Our existing personality does, of course, influence the development of our confidence because it impacts upon our perception of things and how we behave. Personality traits all play their part. For instance, if someone is very shy, they dislike change, they're not open to new experiences, and they worry a lot, then it's likely that these personality traits will negatively impact upon their ability to build confidence if no new social learning occurs. However, our personality need not predetermine our ability to build genuine confidence. This is because how we respond to our emotions, how we perceive events, ourselves, others, and the world, and how we behave can change. With practical guidance, emotional support, time, and practice, we can learn a variety of new skills that can positively influence our personality and make it easier for us to build genuine confidence. All of us can develop genuine confidence, even if our personality means that we might find this difficult at first. It can be developed in our younger years or later on in life, whether we're an extrovert, an introvert, or an ambivert. Simply put, extroverts tend to be outgoing, seek external stimulation, and draw their energy from others. Introverts tend to focus more on their internal world and draw their energy from time alone. Ambiverts have an equal balance of extroversion and introversion. It's a common misconception that extroverts are confident and that introverts are not confident. All people can develop the skills needed to build genuine confidence. You can become an extrovert with genuine confidence, an introvert with genuine confidence, or an ambivert with genuine confidence. The process of building genuine confidence takes time. We're aiming to get to a point where we can experience the feeling of being confident, the attitude of being confident, and the action associated with being confident in a particular context. To begin with, we need two key things: the willingness to try something unfamiliar, the action of confidence, that is, actually doing something unfamiliar and challenging. The formula for building confidence then becomes quite standard. 1. Choose to put yourself in the position where you can learn, be taught, the skill or skills that you seek, either through face-to-face instruction with a teacher or learning through observation, self-directed study, such as reading or watching tutorials, etc. Try to have a clear sense of why you're doing what you're doing. Know your intention. 2. Try, keep trying, learn more, make mistakes, practice and apply your new skills. 3. Reflect upon what happens when you try, the outcomes, and alter your way of being accordingly. 4. Practice some more, as much or as little as needed, until you can apply your new skills effectively. Throughout this process, it's important to remind yourself that it's okay to lack some skills, knowledge, and experience right now. You can learn with time, good teaching, patience, compassion, and encouragement. Don't expect yourself to feel self-assured initially. In fact, it can be helpful to expect the opposite. You may well feel anxious and really unconfident initially, and that's okay. It's completely normal. If you've had little or no experience of doing a particular thing, then the chances are you won't feel confident doing it. What's essential is being willing to try. It's essential for building confidence. Noticing what is needed. Genuine confidence is a sought-after, adaptive experience that's linked with our desires and values. It can help us to pursue our ambitions, perform better, achieve our goals, and experience a greater sense of fulfillment and well-being in various areas of our lives. It can positively impact our interpersonal relationships, friendships, social life, parenting and romantic relationships, work, career, education, leisure time, physical and psychological health, personal development, spirituality, if applicable, role in community life. With this in mind, now consider what you would like to build your confidence for. We always want it for something. Imagine that you go to sleep tonight and a miracle happens. You don't know it, but you have been given the gift of confidence. When you wake up, you don't know that this has happened. What might be different in how you think, feel, or act that might cause you to realize that you're now more confident? Keep a personal notebook close to hand whilst you engage with this book so that you can consider your answers to these prompts and questions and others throughout this book. Reflective writing can really help to deepen our self-insight, clarify what really matters, and build motivation for positive change. Of course, positive change isn't easy. Even if we know what we need to do in order to gain a greater sense of confidence, such as practice something over and over again, the prospect of taking those first steps into the unknown can feel daunting. It can feel like we need confidence in order to build confidence. The Confidence Coach is here to help you with this quandary. Specifically, it's been developed to enable you to do two main things. Identify and understand in detail what gets in the way of you building and enjoying genuine confidence. It will support you to think in depth about the stress-related physical sensations, challenging emotions, automatic thoughts, beliefs and behaviours, resistance and lack of skills, knowledge and experience that contribute to your unwillingness to try. Learn more about what you can do to address these blocks and overcome them in time. It will introduce you to some really helpful self-help tools, like mindfulness, which will support you to cope well with difficult experiences, enhance your self-belief, and increase your willingness to try new things. The information and techniques within this book are inspired by and grounded in acceptance and commitment therapy, ACT, mindfulness, dialectical behaviour therapy, DBT, and cognitive behavioural therapy, CBT, which are proven to enhance psychological well-being and facilitate the development of genuine confidence. With curiosity, openness, and the willingness to read on, you can move closer towards having a deeper understanding of your struggle with confidence. With time, patience, new learning, self-compassion, and practice, you can become the person that you want to be, the person that you truly are. With warm wishes, Dr. Sarah J. Arnold. Understanding our unwillingness. Be curious, not judgmental. Walt Whitman. What gets in the way of you building and enjoying genuine confidence? What stops you from trying? We want to feel more confident and develop confidence in our abilities. So why do we often hesitate and avoid doing the things that we want or need to do? It's not always due to a lack of desire. People commonly report that they really want to do X, Y, or Z, but they just don't. It doesn't make sense, does it? We really want to experience or achieve something, but we don't do it. This occurrence, one that so many of us know, can be helpfully defined as our unwillingness to try. From a psychological perspective, this natural inclination to hesitate and avoid emotionally challenging, uncertain situations that could have unwanted consequences actually makes a lot of sense. Simply put, these situations threaten us. They tend to evoke a stress reaction, a host of sensations, emotions, thoughts, beliefs, urges, and behavioural reactions that can feel really raw and difficult to manage. They also highlight the areas in which we lack skills, knowledge, and experience, which we don't tend to like much either. In the body. When we face the prospect of trying something unfamiliar and challenging, we tend to feel it physically. If we perceive a sense of threat, then it will activate our automatic flight, fight, freeze stress reaction, where the body channels all of its resources into fighting against the threat, trying to avoid it, or freezing in it for self-protection. This stress reaction is hardwired into us, and it's designed to keep us safe. It affects our bodily systems in different and substantial ways. The sympathetic nervous system, part of the body's autonomic nervous system, generates our automatic stress reaction and helps to regulate the body's unconscious automatic functions. This system communicates with our endocrine system, glands that produce hormones, which triggers the release of stress hormones called adrenaline and cortisol that temporarily increase the heart rate, blood pressure, and blood sugar levels and alter the digestion process, helping to fuel our bodies so that we are ready to fight, take flight, or freeze. If, however, the sympathetic system is activated for a prolonged period of time, through chronic stress, for example, it will leave us feeling really depleted. This kind of stress causes the body to respond in the following ways. Our muscles tense up, guarding us against pain and injury and preparing us for action. If this tension lasts for some time, it can result in chronic aches and pains, tension headaches, and so forth. Our breathing rate increases. We breathe harder and faster, providing oxygen-rich blood to the body, readying it for action. However, if we take in too much oxygen, it can upset the natural balance of oxygen and carbon dioxide, CO2, in the body's respiratory system, airway, lungs, and muscles. This can cause panic, hyperventilation, pain, or a sense of pressure on the chest, feelings of unreality, dizziness, and feeling faint. Our cardiovascular system, heart, blood vessels, and blood, enables our heart rate to increase in times of stress. This allows our bodies to receive the nutrients, oxygen, and hormones that we need in order to protect ourselves. Our gastrointestinal system influences how we digest food, absorb nutrients, and how food moves through the body. Stress can affect our stomach, a feeling of butterflies, nausea, and/or pain, and bowels, diarrhea, and/or constipation. Irritable bowel syndrome, IBS, is a common stress-related experience. It's completely normal for our bodies to react in this way, but it can be an exhausting experience, mentally and physically. If the body is feeling really tired and lacking energy due to confidence-related stress, it can block us from wanting to try unfamiliar things. If we've experienced trauma in the past that's negatively affected our confidence, this can be felt and stored in the body too, as anxiety, chronic physical tension, aches and pains. Do you experience difficult bodily sensations when you're feeling unconfident? Experiencing challenging emotions. In times when we intuitively feel the need for self-belief and feelings of confidence, we tend to experience an array of challenging emotions. Anxiety, stress, shame, frustration, sadness, anger, insecurity, vulnerability, and confusion are natural and very common. This happens when we take a risk, step outside of our comfort zone, and face something challenging. Different emotions link with our stress reaction in different ways. For example, anger tends to be associated with our fight reaction. Anxiety often comes with our flight reaction, and feeling overwhelmed, helpless, and vulnerable tends to occur with our freeze reaction. Once triggered, our emotions have a significant impact upon our thoughts, body, and behavior. However, it's our relationship with them, our perception of them, and our relationship with ourselves when we're experiencing them that determines what this impact will be. Many of us don't know how to deal with our emotions well because we haven't been taught. That's not our fault. Unfortunately, the more we judge our emotions, struggle with them, and try to avoid them, the worse we will feel, and the more it will impact upon our confidence. Does your relationship with your emotions affect your ability to build confidence? If so, how? Fusing with automatic thoughts. When we face the prospect of doing something unfamiliar that's challenging, the mind will naturally think thoughts about it. These thoughts come into our minds as words, sentences, ideas, images, and memories without our conscious control. They will enter, stay, and leave the mind whether we like them or not. Habitually and automatically, we tend to listen to our thoughts, believe them, and act in accordance with them, a process called fusion. Fusing with our thoughts is an essential part of life. It enables us to survive, learn, understand ourselves, others, and the world, develop and sustain relationships, problem solve, engage with activities of daily living, work towards our goals, orchestrate our lives, and live well. However, when our thoughts are influenced by stress, fear, or past emotional pain, they can become much less helpful. If we fuse with them, they can stop us from pursuing our dreams, negatively affect our self-esteem, block us from building confidence, and stop us from living the life that we want to live. Here are some common automatic stress-related thinking styles, which can get activated when we want or need to engage in activities that challenge our confidence. Black and white thinking. Seeing only one extreme or another, and not the nuances in between. For example, evaluating an experience as a disaster without acknowledging what went well or better. It's a way of thinking that allows us to make quick decisions in times of stress with minimal hesitation. This typically works in our favour when we're faced with life-threatening stress because we need to react, fight, flight, freeze, quickly. However, with non-life-threatening stress, this thinking style can skew our perception and negatively impact our confidence. Blaming. Often when we fail, or things don't go as we'd hoped, the mind gets hooked into blaming ourselves or blaming others. We might blame ourselves for things that go wrong, or could go wrong, even though we're not responsible or only partly responsible for the outcome. We personalise the outcome anyway and think, it's all my fault. We might unfairly blame others too if we struggle to allow ourselves to make mistakes and find it hard to own them. Catastrophizing. Imagining, fearing, and believing that the worst outcome will definitely happen, that we'll fail, be rejected, feel humiliated, etc. This style of thinking is very predictive, and it reflects our fears. In part, the mind is trying to prepare us emotionally for the possibility of an unwanted outcome. What's more, it's naturally trying to seek some sense of security, predictability, and control in an uncertain situation. Comparing. Comparing ourselves to others. In primitive times, rejection from a social group would most likely mean death. Therefore, doing things right and being good enough wasn't only adaptive, helpful, it was essential. Members of the group would look to each other to compare and monitor their behaviour in order to remain accepted and protected by others. It's believed that this tendency helped early humans to survive. Of course, early humans only had a small tribe of others to compare themselves to. Now, with the internet, the whole world is accessible to us, and we continue comparing ourselves. We're flooded with numerous images of people on social media presenting the most favourable parts of themselves and their lives. This means that we tend to look at others' best traits and strengths and compare these with what we think of as our worst traits and weaknesses. Empty positive thinking. Attempting to comfort and reassure ourselves with phrases like, it'll be fine, which we don't really believe. This way of coping unintentionally dismisses our experience and blocks our ability to engage in effective problem solving. Filtering. When we can only focus on the difficult or unwanted aspects of a given situation, forgetting to consider the things that went okay, well, and the things that we're grateful for. Our minds are hardwired to focus in on the challenging aspects of our experiences because these are the things that might hurt us physically or psychologically. Here, the brain is actually doing its job, looking past the positives, through to the negatives in order to try and keep us safe. Mood-dependent retrieval. When we recall memories that match with our current mood or emotions. For example, you're feeling anxious because you failed at something, and your mind begins recalling all of your past failures too, along with other things that evoke your anxiety. This associative thinking style is a natural, normal psychological phenomenon. Unfortunately, it can cause us to suffer a great deal if we get hooked by these thoughts and become lost in their story. Overgeneralizing. Making inaccurate, overgeneralized statements about yourself and how things are. For example, something will happen and the mind will say, I can't do anything right. In reality, even if you make a lot of mistakes, You can and will do some things right. Watch out for this thinking style. It often arises when we're feeling stressed and reflecting upon our experiences. It can really affect our sense of confidence and our willingness to try something again. Worrying. Fusing with anxious thoughts about a particular task, concern, or fear, and replaying them over and over again in the mind, finding it hard to let them go. Sometimes we get stuck, compulsively focusing on the obstacles and difficulties ahead of us, without considering what we can actually do to help ourselves and respond to these issues. Worrying serves no useful purpose. In actuality, it worsens anxiety and fuels self-doubt. People who find it difficult to tolerate uncertainty, problem-solve, and be assertive may find that they have the tendency to worry. Self-critical voice. Putting ourselves down, criticizing and bullying ourselves, it's a thinking style that often comes up in times of stress, failure, and disappointment, and in those times when we're finding it hard to like ourselves. It is the voice of past pain. It's common in those of us who have been abused, bullied, judged, invalidated, or criticized by others, parents, teachers, peers, partners, etc. It's also common in people who've grown up trying to uphold certain high standards in order to feel loved or be viewed as worthwhile. When mistakes and failures inevitably happen, our self-critical voice gets activated and chastises us. There's anger in this thinking style, and there may be an unconscious self-belief that this venom towards ourselves is somehow deserved. Shoulds. Regularly thinking or saying, I should, they should have, you should, etc. It's a consequence of social learning that creates quite rigid, inflexible ideas, expectations, and standards about how things should be. It can put unreasonable demands and pressures on us and others. Take some time, at a time that suits you, and reflect upon how your automatic thoughts affect your ability to build confidence. If you're not sure, practice tuning into them the next time there's a need for confidence and you notice that you're struggling. Approach your experience of thinking with gentle curiosity and try to get to know what happens in your mind without judging it or it shutting down. Remember, it's the fact that we fuse with our automatic thoughts and get lost in their stories that impedes us and affects our self-confidence. It's not the thoughts themselves. These kinds of thoughts are just a normal part of being human, and we can learn to change our relationship with them. Beliefs and behaviours. The beliefs and expectations that we hold about ourselves, others, and the world have a huge impact on our ability to build and experience genuine confidence because they directly influence what we do and what we don't do. Here are some common beliefs and expectations that can inhibit our willingness to try if we fuse with them, which we naturally tend to do. I have no motivation. It's a common complaint, feeling unmotivated. The mind might tell us that we're too tired, we can't be bothered, or we'll do it later. In actuality, there's always motivation, intention of some kind. Either we'll feel willing to try and be motivated to move towards the chosen goal, or we'll feel motivated not to. When we experience that sense of having no motivation, it's usually because our wish not to do something is greater than our wish to do it. Trying might feel like too big of a risk. Let's acknowledge that poor sleep, diet, and a lack of physical energy do, naturally, also affect our willingness. I'm not in the mood. I need to feel like it. Intuitively, we prefer to wait until we feel mentally and physically prepared, and we're motivated to move towards our chosen goal before we take action. However, if trying evokes a stress reaction that we don't feel equipped to deal with, then most of us won't feel like taking action. Resistance is a natural form of self-protection. What's more, bear in mind that motivation tends to increase during or after a particular task, as we gain self-belief, develop feelings of confidence through practice, and learn that we can cope with our experiences. Anxiety is the enemy. Many people believe that feeling anxiety is the problem. Common beliefs include things like, anxiety is a sign of weakness. I need to get rid of my anxiety. Anxiety stops me from doing the things that I want to do. Whilst these beliefs make intuitive sense, because anxiety can feel so threatening, it's not anxiety itself that limits us. It's our perception of it and our reactions to it. There are countless messages in our society about anxiety as a negative emotion. Many of us were taught that we should be strong, synonymous with suppressing and not expressing our emotions. To cope, a lot of people judge their anxiety, attempt to avoid it, argue with it, suppress it, ignore it, distract themselves from it, and so on. Unfortunately, these control-based strategies tend to make anxiety worse. I'm not good enough. Does this sound familiar to you? Yes, me too. As a consequence of our past pain, fears, perception, and experiences, this is a belief that many of us have come to share. We look at others in comparison to ourselves, and we experience that deeply felt sense that we're not confident enough, not smart enough, not attractive enough, etc. If we fuse with this belief, it can really limit us. A person faced with the prospect of doing something new and challenging might think, I can't do this, automatic thought. They experience resistance, anxiety, and feel tense. They decide not to try because, unconsciously, they fear and expect humiliation and failure. At their core, they believe that they're not good enough, a belief and a fear. Trying feels like too much of a risk because they might fail. If they fail, the mind will view this as confirmation that they're really not good enough. This greatly threatens the person's sense of self, so naturally, they prefer to not try, for self-protection. Unfortunately, not trying tends to create a self-fulfilling prophecy. That is, we protect ourselves from failure, but we also deny ourselves the chance to succeed. These missed opportunities culminate in and leave us with an even greater sense that we're not good enough. And, of course, this leaves us even more unwilling to try. It's another vicious cycle. Many people experience imposter syndrome, chronic feelings of self-doubt and inadequacy that arise from trying, when their not good enough belief gets activated. It's a heavy burden that contributes to isolation, feelings of shame and so much fear, if it's not spoken about, shared and understood. Perfectionism is one way of trying to cope with feeling not good enough and fearing failure. It involves striving to maintain, unrelentingly, high standards at all times in order to feel adequate and acceptable. It's also a way of trying to protect oneself from the psychological pain that would arise if a mistake were to be made. It's part of our fight stress reaction. Of
course. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.